This podcast is brought to you by Patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. Head there to check out exclusive podcasts like Talking Futurama, Talk King of the Hill, the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, and tons more.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy hoy everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where we sully the moment with our price taggery. I'm your host, the Scourge of the Despot, Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons, who is here with me today as always.
Hey, it's Henry Gilbert, and will there ever be a rainbow?
And who do we have on the line?
Diamond Steve Sajdak.
And this week's episode is Blood Feud. This week's episode originally aired on July 11th, 1991, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real-world history.
Oh my god!
Oh boy, Bobby, the second season of 90210 debuts alongside this episode of Simpsons. Terminator 2 rules the box office for the second week in a row, and Paula Abdul's Rush Rush tops the Billboard charts.
Well, we have the perfect guest on for this, the first news item, because, Steve, I'm in love with your Melrose 210 podcast. It's a recap podcast that goes over both 90210 and Melrose Place, and because of your podcast, I learned that between the first and second season of 90210, there was basically like 2 months. They started their second season in July, and this Simpsons episode was pushed to July for one fantastic night of programming. This and Beach Blanket Brandon on the same night.
Yes, I must have watched this back to back. My sister ruled the television, so we would watch 90210 whenever it was on, and I probably was very jazzed to get a reprieve with a brand new Simpsons episode that weirdly in July. I have no memory of it, but I'm positive that must have happened.
Yeah, I was very jazzed as well to see a Simpsons in July. Mm-hmm. Though I at that time, as a kid, I don't think my brain had been trained yet to think Simpsons debuts in the fall, because especially like Simpsons was probably the first primetime show I really paid attention to anyway, and it had a very different thing but its entire run up to this point of like, okay, so the Simpsons has a Christmas special in December, then new episodes in January, yeah, and then it debuts in September, and then, hey, another episode in July. Who's to say that they won't be that all the time?
This was a very special night for me because, you know how when you're a kid you're like happy sometimes, and then you spend your entire adult life trying to chase that again and trying to find it. Perhaps you start a podcast network about it, you know, in your search. And I remember through the age of 9, we were like desperately poor. I lived with my grandma, and then we moved into a house, and I had my own bedroom in the summer of 91, and this was the first new episode, and I thought, could life get better than this? We've got a house, I've got a room and a TV, and there's a new Simpsons on.
Wow.
And yeah, then it was all downhill from there.
You've been chasing that ever since, man. and Terminator 2, I did not see that in the movie theaters. It was I waited to see it on VHS the next year, I think, probably. But about as good as action films get, that Terminator 2. I don't know if it's everybody's favorite James Cameron movie. I do think Aliens is pretty great too. It's one or the other for me.
I've become a snob and love, because I grew up, even now, it's like we're the right age for it. I grew up watching that Terminator 2 right into the ground, but I definitely now as an adult kind of prefer Terminator 1 to it, even though I'll touch my glasses when I do that. I do love both of them, and that movie is one of those, is like the uber action movie for me, like in terms of growing up and remembering what action movies could be.
Yeah, I think I'm on Steve's side, having just rewatched that in a theater during the summer. I think I might be a Terminator 1 guy. But Terminator 2, another childhood memory, I think it might have been the first R-rated movie my parents told me I should watch.
Wow.
At the age of 9. But then again, I just rewatched Darkman. I remember watching that on VHS at the suggestion of my parents. So maybe I saw Darkman on VHS first. Yeah. And that's another R-rated movie. A great movie, by the way.
Mm-hmm. I like the idea that your parents are recommending movies to you, a small child. Like your buddies at the water cooler. Oh, you know, Bob, you know what you should go see? You should go you're like seven. Like, you should go see Terminator. Go for it.
I remember my mom saying, oh, Bobby would like this. So, yeah.
Well, and Terminator 2 was made, like, for our age group, literally. Like, they give, despite its R rating, he is given a teen kid to hang out with. Yeah. Like, T-100 is his new dad.
Yeah, you know? Eddie Furlong in that movie teaches him to talk like Bart Simpson.
Exactly. Yes, yeah.
Yes.
It's so funny. Like, yeah, he should be wearing a Bart t-shirt in it, but, like, he's playing all the games we played. He's hanging out with Bud Nick from Salute Your Shorts just like we all wanted to.
Is there a story about Arnold not doing, and we might have talked about this even on the episode we did together, was Arnold ever approached to do anything for The Simpsons, or was he just never interested in it? Or because it just seems like a match made in heaven. Obviously, they made fun of him mercilessly throughout their entire run, especially the early run. So maybe that was a no-go, maybe? Or,
well, here's,
it's just so odd that he never showed up.
Here's the thing. I think around season 5 or 6 or so, I think they were trying to push a script involving Arnold Schwarzenegger, Bruce Willis, and Sly Stallone on The Simpsons, saying,
oh, wow,
we want you to help promote Planet Hollywood. And the showrunner at the time was like, absolutely not, even if I can get all you voices on the show. And I think to date, neither of those, and none of those actors have been on The Simpsons. So I think maybe that's what soured them.
Al Jean in particular, on all of the shows he showrun, and that goes up to The Simpsons movie, like, he is savage to Schwarzenegger, like, across decades.
Yeah.
He has been, like, he's a bad actor. It was weird how he said that, like, you know, Hitler had some good ideas. He seems like he would be a terrible governor. He had all those things to say for decades, so it's like, yeah, I don't think he'd want to do it. In the end, with that Planet Hollywood script, I think The Simpsons writers end up finding out they were bamboozled anyway, and it was like the agent said they'd do it, but then the actors were like, wait, we never said we'd do that. And yes, Paula Abdul's Rush Rush, that was the song that was in all of our ears as well.
No cartoon for me, no sale.
I know, yeah. It's.
I was going to say, that's not the one where she's flirting with the cat, so then that's kind of not for me then.
If it's not Opposite Attracts, we don't remember, no.
That must have been another furry activation point. Like, I would just love to have those numbers in front of me, which is impossible. Like a big old school, like in Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead, that those big binders full of figures. Like, I just feel like activation points have to be the Robin Hood movie, that video. Like, there's just a lot of them where you're like, yeah, I can see how that could go. I can see it.
I think in 89, it was either you're activated by either Rescue Rangers or Opposites Attract.
Yes. Yeah.
It really affected a lot of kids' sexual development.
And then
that was a sexy cat guy running around fucking Paula Abdul. Not a bad situation.
By the way, I pulled up the video here on my computer just to be sure. Yes, Keanu Reeves is in the Rush Rush video.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. Dang.
Interesting.
Well, I was going to say then after that, the Sonic the Hedgehog series took over activation. But, and I know some fans of Monterey Jack that were also activated, just like Gadget.
Are they in this room?
I'm not telling.
But joining us today is Steven Sajdak of We Hate Movies. Welcome back again to the show, Steve.
I'm very happy to be here. Is this like the third or fourth episode I've been on since COVID, which is so horrible to think about. But it's been fun to catch up with you guys as we go through this never-ending nightmare.
Year three. Also, it's going to turn around in year three, I think.
I think that's it. Biden's riding the dragon this month, folks. He's got it.
And when you mentioned Arnold Schwarzenegger, we did the Simpsons movie with you guys on We Hate Movies. That was our last time I think we recorded together.
I think so, yeah.
That was so much fun, and that's an episode that people freaking loved, so I was really happy to have you guys on it. And I have not visited season 2 in a really long time, and it was kind of interesting. I was very happy that you guys brought me in for this, because I think the last one we did on your show was the Mel Gibson Simpsons episode, speaking of celebrities.
Yeah.
And I was really excited to do that. And I was like, oh, wow, it's just kind of weird, like, outside of my Simpson watching, which is, I'm, you know, a 3 to, like, 10 person that I'm constantly in rotation with those. Anytime I go outside of that, but I know that I've seen them, it takes me way back into a very bizarre place of like nostalgia and like, oh, these jokes. That's why I say this is because of this episode that I haven't thought about in 5 to 10 to 12 to 15 years.
This episode is a season 2 episode, but it has like the energy of a season 4 episode. Mm-hmm. I feel like for me, this is really where it begins. The golden age, if you want to call it that. I mean, season 2, you don't want to throw that away, or season 1. There's lots of great moments, but here I feel like they realize the comic potential and they realize they don't need this pat emotional ending on every episode. They can have just a shrug. I think that's the mission statement for the rest of the show. I mean, Seinfeld, I think too much gets credited for the show about nothing, when really the Seinfeld is not about nothing. It's about a lot of things. It's about social interactions. It's about faux pas, lots of things. This show is often a bunch of stuff happened and it was funny, wasn't it? So we don't really need a point.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's only separated by like 6 weeks with this and the official start of season 3. If this hadn't been, it's just such a random choice they made that I feel like was, I would guess it was first in the episode guide that they put out that they decided this is a season 2, not a season 3. And then after that, it would be in the DVD set. They're like, yes, this is a season 2 episode. But really, it's like they called the Michael Jackson episode that follows this the season premiere at the time, like that's how they promoted it, but this is the start of season 3. Like season 2 ended in May and this is like 2 months after this. Like this is really the, and it's also weird that like this is the end of season 2 but it's with the start of a Beverly Hills season, like 90210. Yes. Its seasons started, and it's weird they didn't classify this as a season premiere. I guess only reason because there wouldn't be new Simpsons again until yep. September, I suppose. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just this kind of weird dead island of content where you're like, well, here comes season 3 in 2 months. So it's like this weird epilogue. It is kind of, yeah, it's almost like a comic annual almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's outside of the numbering series, but you know that it speaks to whatever is going on at that time.
And you know, Steven, yeah, you mentioned comics. I wanted to compliment you on here. I was just listening to new at the time you are recording this. The Eternals podcast you did for We Hate Movies, that was really great. Like, it was just a wonderful discussion of that film that is so long and yet so forgettable. And just how even Jack Kirby, you know, it's not a home run every time. Even when you're the king of comics, it's not a home run every time. Yeah.
And I think that's my new, I mean, I'm sure someone can call me on it and say, oh, this character, this movie is great, even though this character never sold. But I feel like if a comic series is routinely canceled, chances are there's not enough interest there to hold a major motion picture. I think that's a decent rule to take.
And it's like with Kirby, Eternals never felt special to me as a kid. And I've read almost all the Kirby stuff, and it's like New Gods was his best riff on that idea. Like, so good. And even that is incredibly unfriendly to new readers. And then you've got the Inhumans. That's the second best version of that. And then I'd say below that is actually everything he did with Thor and all of the Norse god stuff. That's also the same kind of story. And then below that is Eternals. So it's like the fourth best version of the story Kirby told many times.
He loved the mythology. He loved the idea of, oh my gosh, wouldn't it be interesting if superheroes were gods, et cetera, et cetera. And yes, you're right. He's told that so many times in so many better iterations than the Eternals, which I've just been reading, and it's fun Kirby stuff, but even still, it's just kind of weak sauce, I'll be honest.
Well, and like I do think Stan Lee takes too much credit for every single thing he was involved in, but oppositely, I also think Jack Kirby, it was at his best when him and Stan Lee were working together on things, and Eternals meanwhile is proof of like, well, if Jack Kirby got to do whatever he felt like, sometimes it's like really loose and he maybe needed an editor occasionally.
Yes, and or someone to be like, you know what might be fun? I don't know, nothing to do with Gilgamesh or gods or anything like that. What if we just like, I don't know, went to New York City and it was jazzy, baby? You know, that kind of thing.
Very distracted by the idea of a character named Sprite in that movie.
Now, just get thirsty.
If that movie was directed by somebody less respected, people would be like, it's pretty sus you have a story about a child that's an adult and wants to date adults. Like, that's weird, you know? But I mean, it's just them being true to the source material. But I was like, I don't like Icarus. Should just be like, no, I'm not attracted to you at all, Sprite. I'm sorry. Like,
it would be, that would make a lot of sense. And why make a baby god if you're making robots anyway? There's a lot of, it just, I could go through it again. But it's just, it's so confusing as to why that child is in that movie that nobody wanted.
And then at the end of the movie, they just have to go like, oh, well, you're going to age now because this actor can't look, unlike other, the adult actors in this, yeah, this actor won't look ageless. So
one more preamble thing about Blood Feud, by the way. I don't mean to interrupt the internal chat, I do think that this really is where they figure out Mr. Burns. I feel like Brush with Greatness was a great first step towards that by throwing him into that story. But in this episode, he is so full of pith and vinegar, as he says, so full of energy and has all of these great rants. And we can see the extremes of his evil at this portion of the show.
The story sticks with him the entire time, pretty much. I think he has more scenes than Homer does in this episode. And and also, this is when they made him 100. Like, he was 80 before, but in this episode, like, he makes references that the only way they could work is if he is 100 years old in 1991. and that's great.
He's also the one thing, I agree with all that, does have his earlier voice. The it's a bit more gusto that Shearer was doing it, as opposed to the later 3, 4, like 4, 5, like, where he's definitely a little bit more wispy. And it's kind of funny when he's dying like he does in sort of quote-unquote classic Simpsons, but when he comes back, it's got this, you know, this kind of not edge to it, but like a girth to the voice that you don't really get often.
Well, yeah, Bob, you also mentioned the airing strategy of Fox, that they're like, no, we want to be big in the summer, we're gonna get a jump on all of the networks. I tried to look up how successful that was for them, because like the wiki will say, you know, its ratings were this or that, but I wanted to find contemporary news. So I went to the LA Times archives, and a week after this, it said that Fox was still fourth for the week, even though they had the only new thing on that was like regular programming. Beverly Hills 90210 was 17th nationally, though in the Los Angeles market, it was in second place for the week. And The Simpsons was 24th nationally. So still didn't really raise Fox all that much, even having brand new stuff.
They did a similar thing in season 10 with Lard of the Dance. That one aired in August alongside, I believe, the debut of That 70s Show. So they did this one more time.
That's right.
Interesting. I'm interested about The Simpsons and 90210 specifically, or The Simpsons actually, about how much maybe Fox getting the NFL really catapulted. I mean, obviously The Simpsons was a phenomenon, t-shirts, etc., and all that stuff, but like really the rate, like just the idea of having the NFL as a lead-in, and just, or if you're watching football games, it's like The Simpsons is coming on next, like how much that has to do with this catapulted to 30 years of success kind of thing.
Well, you know, The Simpsons definitely, it just kind of became an institution. But before they got Major League Sports, Fox was just like, it was like four fads in a row. Like it was like Married with Children was their first one, then Simpsons, then 90210. I feel like there's
Melrose
one more.
Place.
Yeah, Melrose Place. And then
X-Files a little bit.
I mean, and X-Files.
More of a little cultier, probably.
No, but it was still like headlines, and in front, it was their Twin Peaks, which got them like a bunch of new viewers. And then Major League Baseball comes in, and right at, and then 2 years after Major League Baseball, I think it's the NFL. And then they're a real network with 5 nights a week of programming and all that.
Yeah.
Or seven nights, not five. But and this also was directed by, say, David Silverman, who says that this was one of his favorites ever to direct, which this has a lot of fun animation in it too. And and also he shouts out a guy who I've now added to my Rolodex of like, I'd like to interview this guy who's still active in the animation industry. His name is Mike Gerard. He shouts him out because for the honestly best looking years of The Simpsons to me animation wise, he was the overseas animation director, which is a hugely important thing to the execution of animation that you output overseas. So and he's still working the animation industry to this Day.
Yeah, as somebody that's been a little season two agnostic, and I watched a couple of these this week, the faces you get in these episodes you will never see again. Mm-hmm. Just like the amount of when Marge is trying to tell Homer that they're partners and, you know, they have to be in this together, there's so much emotion in that one drawing. I found it really emotionally satisfying in a way that I feel like a lot of times, and not to shit on, you know, even my favorite Simpsons stuff, but like there's, I don't know, I really was, the animation of this episode is really inspiring and interesting to look at.
Mm-hmm. I agree. And as for the writing, this was a very interesting week for them writing it, because it's the end of their production season. As we said many times before, when you get at the end of a Simpsons production year, you are exhausted. You are like dying. You've had no sleep and you want to pump out this last script and be done with it and take a vacation. And as we've talked about an episode that will come out after this, but we've recorded already, the parent rap, the last one of production season 12, also co-written by George Meyer, the writer of this episode. It's when you get zanier and you don't care as much about like a heartfelt ending. You're yeah, more about like, yeah, let's fucking yep, have some fun, guys. Oh no, well, and also this was technically still in production season two, but a test balloon for Al Jean and Mike Reese as showrunners for the show, as Al Jean talks about on the commentary. As Sam Simon, the showrunner of seasons one and two, he was having his problems with Matt Groening. They weren't getting along. And then on top of that, Bob has laid out before, the James L. Brooks and Gracie sells a new sitcom to ABC, a live action one called Sibs. And so Sam Simon, it was a great solution. Sam Simon, you run this show and go away from Matt Groening and no more problems.
I mean, you're going to hear about Sib soon, but just a preview. It debuted on the same day as Home Improvement, same night rather. Did not become the number one hit that show did.
Yeah, I'm going to jettison. This Simpsons thing is on autopilot. I'm more interested in what's going on Sibs, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to hitch my star to Sibs.
And so Gene and Reese, they are working very hard on this. And I do think that because Gene and Reese were so, you know, like, we got to do this perfect and it's got to be perfect kind of thing, I think too that got them less involvement from James L. Brooks, who for most of this season too seems to show up at the end to be like, no, you got to pull on the heartstrings. Where's the emotion at the end? We need the emotion. This yeah, is like spitting in the face of the emotion that's ended so many season two episodes.
Yeah, we talked about throughout season two how, you know, the show could never have been a success without James L. Brooks, but a few times throughout the season he has kind of made things a little too sappy, like things like what, Dancing Homer was an ending basically pulled out of re-edited video footage.
Yes, just to have more emotion to it. And same with like a late addition to the on the Dignities on Me, friends, like that just embarrasses yeah, the writers on the commentary. Also they mentioned it, that Harry Shearer couldn't make the recording the table read for this episode, which was rare then, not something he has done for 20 years straight at this point. But on that episode, they were really worried of like, oh, fuck, we don't have Harry Shearer here. This is Burns and Smithers is on every scene.
He was like, sorry, guys, I can't put the show on hold. Yeah. It's just too funny.
Well, yep, it's the funniest thing on TV, on the radio.
The Simpsons will be right back.
Hey, paper baghead!
Oh, man. I'm dead meat on a stick.
How much money you got, Simpson?
$1.03, Mr. Bully, sir.
Keep a change.
Thanks, man.
Think I'll take that Butterfinger, too.
Think again, Nelson.
Get a crispity, crunchity, peanut buttery burst in every bite of Butterfinger.
Nobody better lay a finger on my Butterfinger.
And try new Butterfinger ice cream bars.
Cool, man. Butterfinger on a stick.
Welcome to the break, everybody, and a big thank you to our certified bloodletting tech dude, Steven Sajdak. We always love having him on. Everybody should check out the great stuff he does on We Hate Movies. And don't forget that me and Bob last year did a great episode of that about the Simpsons movie you should definitely check out. And if you're enjoying the Talking Simpsons podcast, you really should be checking out patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Subscribers to that are why me and Bob can do this as our full-time jobs. The $5 a month subscribers there get to know that they're helping me and Bob pay our rent, and they also get tons of exclusive things for that $5. Each month you get a new episode of Talking Futurama and Talk King of the Hill, of us covering Futurama and King of the Hill one episode at a time each month, just like we do on The Simpsons. There's a giant back catalog of us covering other shows like The Critic, Mission Hill, and Batman the Animated Series, super duper in depth, and tons of other exclusives too in our 5 years of being on Patreon. Check it all out, $5 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But if you want something as nice as extrapolopakettle, then you need to sign up at the $10 a month level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, because you get all that $5 stuff I just talked about. But then you get our monthly premium podcast, What a Cartoon Movie, where we cover an animated feature film super duper in depth, just like we do on The Simpsons. That often means we talk for over 5 hours about a different animated feature film scene by scene and going deep into the history. At the end of this month, you're going to hear me and Bob talk about South Park the Movie, bigger, longer, and uncut, as chosen by our patrons. And the last month we covered The Lion King 2, Simba's Pride. In March, we're going to be doing Pinocchio, the Golden Age Disney classic, and a giant back catalog, over 3 years worth of What a Cartoon Movies, over 225 hours of us covering things as diverse as Kiki's Delivery Service, Cowboy Bebop, Beavis and Butthead to America, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and tons and tons and tons more. Check it all out at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons today to see what you're missing out on. But all right, this episode, though, begins with a great setup of a hilarious traffic warning sign turned into a nuclear disaster warning sign. They were new in Los Angeles at the time. So this is LA writers talking about LA traffic. That's really what it's about.
I think you see some of these in Terminator 2, or maybe I'm thinking of Falling Down.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, Falling Down has them a lot. Maybe there is. I don't remember in Terminator 2 that they have those, but they're very famous in the movie L.A. Story, where I think something, and I haven't seen the movie in forever, but Steve Martin like proposes to Sarah Jessica Parker via L.A. traffic sign, or like, will you forgive me, or something like that.
Yeah.
So these are huge for L.A. folk.
But in this case, this is such a hilarious thing about how the warnings are disquieting everybody, like as they realize, like, oh, a nuclear disaster means we're all dead. There's no warning to be had.
Less clapping during Meltdown Flea City. Yes. A few people are still clapping.
Core Explosion Repent Sins is such a great... It, like, there's a period. That's my favorite bit. Core Explosion, period. Repent Sins, period.
So grim.
And also this Meltdown joke, then, you know, a few months later in Homer Defined, they just go all the way, like, you know what? No, a Meltdown does happen. We're just going to do it.
It happens like twice in that episode.
That's right. Yeah. First in Springfield, then in Shelbyville. As they are about to unveil it, Mr. Burns is a no-show in our first clip.
Joke's on them. If the core explodes, there won't be any power to light that sign.
And now I would like to present the man who made this sign possible. By dropping the last of his obstructionist legal challenges, Montgomery Burns.
Mr. Burns is never late. Something must be terribly wrong.
Well, there better be. Nobody leaves Diamond Jewel Quimby holding a bag.
Must turn over. Got to greet dignitaries.
Oh, no. Mr. Burns, we've got to get a doctor.
Absolutely not. No quack sawbones is going to apply his leeches to me. As long as there's an ounce of strength left in me, I...
His wiggling arms is so funny. Like, what a great drawing.
Even more Citizen Kane-y things.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. This scene here, this is like back-to-back Citizen Kane scenes, because the discovery of him is very similar to the discovery of Charles Foster Kane after his death. And then in the next scene, it's meant to mirror when Smithers visits him at his bedside with a doctor. That's when Kane's second wife attempts suicide, and they're visiting her in the bed. In her bed as well.
I love the blocking on that scene too. Like, that's real commitment to the joke. It's very cinematic, where like the camera stays on Burns and Smithers and Hibbert just go to the recede to the back. It's really funny.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Earlier I said they really figured out Mr. Burns. This one they really figure out Smithers. The pieces are coming together in Brush with Greatness. I think the dynamic between those two characters, they are like, oh, this is lots of fun.
Yes.
Here you really learn what Smithers is about at this portion of the show.
He's a softy too. Like, he's not the jerk. He was a jerk this season. One of the first episodes is Simpson and Delilah. And in that, Smithers is just an asshole. Like, he ruins Homer's career seemingly out of just normal executive behavior of like, yeah, you're not gonna overtake me in the company. But this is much more the Smithers who's like, yeah, I'm your best friend. Like, thank you, Burns. Let's hang out.
Yes, and he has given Mr. Burns a kidney already, which really hit the spot, and is ready to give blood at the drop of a hat. Somehow rips through a jacket and a sweater and a button-down shirt.
He's super strong.
He's incredibly strong.
That's how passionate he is. You know, it's the adrenaline just rushing through him. I love this line because it is just the man who made this sign possible. By dropping the last of his obstructionist legal challenges like that. And it's seemingly this whole event because Burns did this out of the goodness of his heart, but it's actually that he finally got convinced, all right, just drop your lawsuits. You have to put this up. That's so great. And then he seemingly has made an enemy for life out of Quimby by leaving him looking bad at the podium.
On your suggestion, I rewatched Three Men in a Comic Book, and it's funny to get two Diamond no one does this to Diamond Joe Quimby jokes back and forth because there's one last episode with Jimbo, and Jimbo says Radiation Man, you dumbass, or whatever. And he's like, no one makes a fool out of Diamond Joe Quimby. It's a fun runner. And I miss Diamond. I love the term Diamond Joe Quimby. I'll never not laugh at that.
It was there from the beginning. I was like, did they invent this for this show? But no, in Bart Gets an F, episode one, his placard or whatever, his symbol says Diamond Joe Quimby.
It's funny too to see Quimby before he just became a receptacle for Kennedy jokes and mainly being a philanderer. These jokes are about how he instantly makes you like a political enemy for life if you embarrass him one time. He's like, get that punk's name. That's his joke. Once they heard Castellaneta's version of Quimby, they're like, you know what? Kennedy jokes are just so much more fun. Let's why fight against this? Let's just go full on with Kennedy stuff.
And this is a bit of a blood chat for all you blood fans out there because we got some things wrong last time, I think, and that was 5 years ago. We've grown so much as people since then, but
we've learned a lot about blood.
Double O negative isn't real. Hypohemia isn't real. Type O negative is a real blood type. It's the most useful blood type because you can give it to anybody,
right?
And I think they're implying, well, double O negative is the reverse of that.
I get it. That makes okay. That finally makes sense to me. That joke. I knew it was a made up blood type, but the idea is that nobody. You can only get that blood type from another of that. Like, it can't take any other type, and it's very rare. Got it. Okay. Well, one, I love that Smithers won't even wait for like a few seconds to sterilize a needle. He's like, nah, I don't even care. Get it to him right now. But
also, leave me enough to get home is a great idea.
Yeah. Though apparently the original line, just leave me enough to get home to my wife and kids.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
I always wonder if they never clarify if it was cut in full animation or cut in the script phase or maybe the animatic phase, because the way he says just leave me enough to get home, you could totally see that they just cut out the next like 2 seconds where he said to my wife and kids, and I think that was the right move, because if you make Smithers like a closeted guy who is lying to a wife and children, that changes the tone of his relationship with Burns far too much.
Yeah,
you know? Yeah, I much prefer him as a man who just has a Yorkie Terrier at home and
Hercules. And a killer blog about Malibu Stacy, a proto blog rather.
He was leading the forums or the message boards for StacyCon 94.
Although future showrunner Al Jean on the commentary for this recorded like literally 20 years ago, so I think he's changed his mind. Like, yes. He considers Smithers a Burns-asexual, but we've all learned that Smithers is gay for other men as well.
Yes, and I mean, I almost think that he wouldn't even, given it, he would just, it's not even he's attracted to Mr. Burns, but in a way that, like, an untouchable, like, he's God, I could never touch that. Mm. Like, I'll have sex with John Waters or whomever else, whatever the gay man happened to be in Springfield, but I will look up to Mr. Burns.
Yeah, it's funny to me that Gene felt that, you know, 20 years ago when they recorded that commentary, because, you know, the people who followed him, like, as showrunner on the show, they wrote Smithers as a gay man. Like, you know, in Merkin seasons, they wrote Smithers as, yes, he is gay. He frequents gay clubs. Like, he turns on the Republican Party and Sideshow Bob because it disagrees with his choice of lifestyle, as he puts it then. And then on top of that, in the Bill and Josh seasons, he just dates men and goes goes to Fire Island. I don't agree with the idea that, like, if Burns was a frog, he'd love frogs. It's like, no.
Smithers, no, yeah, exactly.
Well, and these days, for the last like 4 or 5 years, Smithers is just an openly gay man on the show. He's not in the closet or anything. Also, I looked up what is the rarest blood type in the United States. It's AB. Though apparently, and type O positive is the most common. Though apparently AB being the rarest, it actually is, though, the most on hand at blood banks, because they know it's the rarest. They actually keep it around the most. And also, you know, some people might say, as I first thought, wait a minute, if their blood types don't match, how can he give him his kidney? But technically, if you don't have the same blood type, you might be able to give people your kidney.
Okay.
So, like, as this is according to a Google search, AB blood type patients can get a kidney from any blood type. A patients can get kidneys from people with O or A type. B patients can get kidneys from O or B type blood. So it is possible that in the fictional world of a double O negative blood, perhaps it can still take a kidney from someone else.
If we see an X-ray of Smithers on the show from this point onward, there better be one kidney in there.
Absolutely. I'll go fucking nuts. I also, I'm always terrified of having to give someone my kidney. Those boys stay in my body. Hate to break it to you, everybody. They're not going anywhere.
I think the later George Meyer show run episode of Homer giving the kidney to Abe did make me scared of, like, but if I gave a kidney, doesn't that shorten my life? Or can I drink as much? Like, all the things that were jokes in that episode, I took as fact and did not read more about kidney dangers.
Yeah, my kidneys are doing a lot of work, especially over the past 2 years. They've got a lot to process.
Yeah, you probably guess what, you don't even want them. That's kind of the way I'm treating it. It's like, it's a car I don't want to give back. It's like, no, these are mine.
Or maybe now nobody even would want our kidneys. Like, we're too old for it. Just like, it's like, well, you don't have to worry about the draft anymore because they wouldn't want you in the army anyway. You're too old. Like, same deal. Kidneys too old. But yes, as everyone realizes that Burns doesn't have long to live, Smithers is desperate.
Attention all employees. Our boss and inspiration, Mr. Burns, is at death's door. If you have type 00 negative blood, I implore you to report to the bloodmobile outside. That is all.
I give him my blood except for one thing.
What's that?
I don't wanna.
I can't believe you guys. There's a human being out there with millions of dollars who needs our help.
And you don't want to cash in? That's why you losers are stuck in this crummy dead-end job.
You know, Homer, I am your supervisor.
Sorry, sir.
That is not consistent in the show. Carl is not written as his manager, but I love that. Like, I've been on the other side of the workforce, not as a child watching this, it's like occasionally there can be moments where the person you're joking around with will pull rank on you and you have to go like, sorry sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
I do love, for that joke only, they put Carl in a tie in this episode or in that one scene to just make it look like he maybe he got promoted yesterday and then he gets demoted at the end of the episode.
Yeah, everyone's more dressed up. They're all wearing badges.
Yeah.
And this thing with Homer pinning up the "you want it when" joke fax, it brought me back to the days of joke faxes where my mom was at an office. She was a nurse. She was at an office with a fax machine and she would bring them home. Like, that. This is how memes were spread in olden times. And the one she hung up in her bedroom was, it was a cat and its hair was in curlers, had a handgun pointed at you, the viewer, and it says, "I have a gun in PMS. Any questions?"
Wow.
So that was being faxed into the hospital. Now you'd be fired.
I love that Homer is so into all of these. Like the professional comedy writers of The Simpsons are making fun of what hack signs are and like jokes around the office, like "you want it when," like they. But Homer is so entertained by it. And this time, I love how he says, like, he calls Burns our boss and inspiration, like so heady. If I was there, I certainly would say, like, "Oh yeah, I'm on Carl's side. I don't wanna, like, yeah, let him die. Let this old asshole die."
It's always a thing, though. You can always have a worse boss. That's
sure.
And, you know, working for a company, you don't want someone to swoop in and then now you're working for the, well, actually, no, the Germans were good, but they fired Homer. So it's kind of, Homer is lucky to be where he is, I guess, is the idea. And maybe leaving well enough alone as best you can is good.
The Germans fire him because they're good. They're actually like, wait, this man should not work here. This is not a crazy sitcom. Like, we have to fire this guy. I suppose in the event of death, though, it would be inherited by, I guess his mom would take it or just go to the board of directors, perhaps, I guess. Cut back home. Maggie is being shown a bunch of flashcards. This is one of those jokes I think Groening is really into, the idea that Maggie is secretly the smartest Simpson. Like, they've put that in so many classic episodes. Yeah, that, and I guess it's partially because Lisa is training her with these flashcards for Zeebos.
And lemurs, back when we didn't know what lemurs were. And the 94 comes around, we're all crazy about lemurs.
Yeah, so we're nuts about lemurs. I kind of love the Lisa's back and forth with Marge with, you know, I'm trying to give her all the advantages I never had. And, you know, obviously it's hilarious because she's a small child anyway. And Marge is telling me, like, I don't know, we did our best. Like, yeah. she's kind of offended by it, which I kind of love.
And then she immediately changes the subject. She's like, what's a Zeebo? Yes.
What's a Zeebo? No, it's so great. She's like, Lisa, we did the best we could. Like, it's so funny that Marge is offended. Like, you're 8. Like, how can you already tell me that we failed you as parents? Though they have failed her as parents. And it not only taught me what a Zeebo was, but also a hump and a dewlap. I did not know those terms for animal shapes then. And you better believe after this, as soon as I could get to a reference section of my school library, I looked up to see if a Zeebo was a real thing. And then it pulled out probably the Encyclopedia Britannica, I would guess, at my local library. Zeebo is it's a funny word. And apparently, you know what? Some people, they're used all around the world, but mainly in India as sort of, you know, pack animal, like as in, you know, like a steer or cattle you would use. But a Zeebo also, though, they have bred miniature Zeebos that people have as pets around the world.
A domesticated Zeebo. I like this.
Though they seem like bigger from pictures I saw, miniature. I mean, it's smaller than a Zeebo, a normal one is, but it's bigger than a big dog. Like, it's not like a tiny little thing. It's not cat size. I'd take a cat size Zeebo. Oh, you know.
You don't want to hear those hooves rattling around all night.
Yeah, it's true. Mess up. I'd scratch up the hardwood floor around my apartment. but yes, this joke next of them asking her what their blood types are. Homer, as an adult man, should know his blood type. But then again, if I didn't have my driver's license to look at, I'd probably forget as well.
I don't know if mine's on my driver's license. This episode always makes me think, do I know my blood type? I need to call my mom.
I do know mine only because I gave blood at work once. They were it's a not a rare blood type, but a very sought after blood type. So now the Red Cross calls me all the time. I do try to give blood and/or platelets like 2 or 3 times a year, but I haven't because I'm a very good person. I want to get credit for this.
You're good
anyway. You can. Yeah, the thing is, my wife does a lot of like actually good things, like volunteering and stuff like that. I'm like, I don't know. You can cut me open and just take this stuff that I'm not using, and I could just kind of like listen to music while you do it and feel kind of weak for a day. That's my thing.
I'm just thinking a lot of people are hearing about Steve's rare blood.
Yeah. See, you don't want to dox yourself on your blood type, though, on the podcast.
That's why I didn't say it. I'll never. Leave. I don't want some freaks coming after me, any more freaks.
Me as a kid, this was one of those jokes that gave me more respect for my mom. Of like, wow, my mom has to memorize all that stuff. She has to know what my brother or I is allergic to or what our hat size is or whatever. And my mom, unlike Marge, had a full-time job as well. She had to remember all that stuff with like it. I respect her more now, but I think it's funny that Lisa's reaction, like, you know, his blood type, how romantic. Like, what? Of course, in Japan, it is used for matchmaking.
That is true.
Know, yeah. I always wondered why with anime characters, sometimes it would list like, well, yeah, this Sailor Moon's blood type is this, but Sailor Venus's blood type is this. And it was, it's kind of a horoscope thing.
Yeah. It's like
much.
Astrology.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. That makes sense to me. I remember like just cards, and, like, you know, comic book cards, and God knows, like, whenever it gets to blood type, you're like, okay, guys, that's a little too much information. I'm not going to get anything out of it. But I guess if you treat it that way, you treat it that way.
One of my favorites on the cards of ridiculous things for comic book cards was in the first Marvel trading cards run, which I love so dearly, they would make up win loss records like it was a baseball card.
Yes, I remember that.
and I think I feel pretty sure they were not based on fact of like, if you were to have counted every time Spider-Man appeared in a comic book and his wins and losses, I don't think that's the actual number. I think they just made it up, but I loved to imagine they actually counted, like, okay, this episode issue he fights two people, one win, one loss. Write it down, guys.
Yeah, you basically have to some poor editorial assistant had to like cycle through the archives for those actual win loss records.
but yes, as they learn, Bart actually does have this very rare blood, which has never been a part of the series ever before or after. But yeah, Bart.
Oh wait, second time in this season he's given blood. Barbara's Thanksgiving.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Man, you know, he got shortchanged on his blood at that Thanksgiving at the blood center he gave it to.
This little kid's gushing all over this season.
Yeah, wow.
Do kids give blood? Can kids give blood is a question?
You know, I bet in a medical emergency like this, yes, he can. But yeah, I mean, the joke in the Thanksgiving episode is he needed a fake ID to give blood for that.
I mean, I'm sure we'll talk about this soon. But isn't that Peter Thiel's kind of thing?
To
stealing blood from babies.
People. Yes, yeah, mm-hmm. That's his thing. Allegedly, in some articles, yes. Like, I mean, you know.
Oh, yeah, this is, I'm saying if this happened in a video game,
yes,
it'd be a fun
yes.
premise.
Yeah, yeah, that's all. This is we're parodic characters. We're not even ourselves here on this podcast.
No,
really.
Yeah, that's my name is made up.
Yeah, yeah, but yes, Bart doesn't want to give blood, and Homer's got to talk him into it.
Congratulations, boy, you've got a date with a needle.
Hey, wait a minute, I don't have to give blood. I have rights, you know.
Yeah, you have the right to remain silent.
Bart, you have to help someone in need. It's the only decent thing to do.
No.
Bart, it's not like I'm asking you to give blood for free. That would be crazy. You're a little young to understand this, but when you save a rich man's life, he showers you with riches. Don't you know the story of Hercules and the lion?
Is it a Bible story?
Yeah, probably. Anyway, once upon a time, there was a big, mean lion who got a thorn in his paw, and all the village people tried to pull it out, but nobody was strong enough. So they got Hercules, and Hercules used his mighty strength, and bingo! Anyway, the moral is, the lion was so happy, he gave Hercules this big thing of riches.
How did a lion get rich?
It was the olden days.
Yeah, that's a great set.
Not a great explanation from Homer there.
It's great, you know. I never considered it till now, but this is kind of foreshadowing of there is no moral to this story that Homer tells or of this episode.
Yes.
I was like, well, the moral is you're given money for doing a good thing. That's the moral of the story.
Even his plan when he tries to explain it does not actually work in any logistical way, shape, or form.
And Homer should like, okay, okay, if you wanted money for it, Homer is assuming Burns will do it out of the goodness of his heart. Homer should have at least said, like, no, we are selling you this blood. Like, this blood cost you $1 million. Give it to us, and then you can have the blood. Apparently, there are many thorns out of a lion paw's story out there, but I think it goes back to Androcles and the lion from olden times, Aesop fables from, like, the Roman era, I suppose. But I always, as a kid, heard more of the mouse taking it from the lion's paw.
Yes.
That the lion's a jerk to the mouse, and then the moral of that story is, hey, just because someone's weaker than you doesn't mean they can't help you, and you should be nice to them. And though in some of the Androcles stories, he's given a bunch of money. In other ones, the lion says, oh, I owe you a favor, and then later Androcles needs some help, and the lion's like, hey, I vouch for this guy. He helped me out. Let me...
Just like a lion that just owes me a favor, you know, maybe a mafia lion, possibly. I like this. I like where all this is going.
You want a lion in your corner, really.
I would think at first Androcles was like, oh boy, a lion owes me a favor. Great. If I ever need a dead zebra, I'll come to you. We head over to the blood bank, or the blood bank mobile. Otto is the driver of it. It's one of his second jobs. I think it's the first time we've seen him do something other than drive the bus. I love, he says, like, yeah, when all my friends are in school, I can't hang out with them. So I got a job as a certified bloodletting tech dude. And Steven, could you identify the song he was humming as he was cleaning his hands up?
Was this Iron Maiden?
Iron Man.
Yeah.
Iron Man.
And I bet they had to pay to get that much of Iron Man on.
It's very identifiable of Iron Man. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Using the wet nap to clean up is a nice touch, too.
Yes.
I always like that joke.
Huge slam on on blood techs out of nowhere, man. These people work hard. They're not exactly stoners that are using wet naps, I would hope.
That's true. Yeah, who are both, like, ate a bunch of fried chicken and then changed the like gears on the back of the bus too. And it's the return of Shakespeare's fried chicken, first seen in The Way We Was. Unfortunately, they didn't get that fried chicken as much as they. It was like a season two thing, really. The Shakespeare's fried chicken.
Yeah, usually they just would go to Krusty Burger for fast food jokes.
Yeah,
after this.
As Smithers shows up, I also like that Homer's like, you hug him. Hug Bart. I don't want to hug you.
Yes, yeah. I don't know. Well, he asks who wants to get hugged first, which is like, yeah, I'm good, man.
The
Thank
boy.
You.
The boy. Yeah. We have a fun little scene of passing a blood bag very quickly, and then one guy just forgets he's in the elevator. What a great time killer of a joke there. And then Burns is on his last legs. I just laugh. Every drawing of Burns, like, with his mouth open, like, nearly dead is so funny looking.
I also like the silly sound effect of the blood draining into his body, like someone sucking on a mostly empty soda cup.
Yeah. Oh, so funny.
Honestly, he gives him a lot. They take a lot of blood from this tiny little kid, by the way. Like, it's a lot.
Yeah.
A
full bag like that, that does seem like a lot to take out of Bart.
We saw that he passed out in Bart versus Thanksgiving.
Yeah, that seems like even more blood than that much. Yeah, I honestly, it was a real physical risk to Bart, and he deserves to be paid. Like, it's, I wish they'd have shown that there was some physical side effect to Bart in this one. But you know what? George Meyer wrote that episode too, the Thanksgiving one. Yeah.
Wow.
In that one, George Meyer tells a story that he tried to get money for giving blood, and the people at the blood bank said, like, you just can't show up and give blood. You have to run through a test. You can't just give blood.
Well, we'll talk about another inspiration for this episode later, I assume. But one of them was, it said on the commentary, one of the producers needed a blood transfusion.
Right.
And they got the idea, like, oh, what if Burns needed one? So it all started there. So maybe this happened before he wrote Bart vs. Thanksgiving. Like, blood transfusions, that's hilarious.
Boy, let's try to guess at the physical problems that a Simpsons writer was going through then. Which one was it? No, I'm not going to name people. Then Burns reads his epitaph, which... this also feels a bit Citizen Kane to me. Not that there's there's not a scene in Citizen Kane where he's like, where he's dying and he gives his epitaph, but definitely in the at the start of Citizen Kane, he does say, like, remember, at all times I am an American.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yes.
But here's Mr. Burns' epitaph.
We're ready with the transfusion.
Smithers, I'm not going to make it. I want to dictate my epitaph.
Go ahead.
Charles Montgomery Burns.
Mm-hmm.
American.
Mm-hmm.
And patriot, American patriot. Master of the atom. Scourge of the despot. Oh, tyrant, hear his mighty name, and quick, Smithers, I'm back. Oh, top of the morning to ye. Wait, look who's here. It's good old you.
Hi, Mr. Burns.
Oh, hey there, Mr. Brown Shoes. How about that local sports team?
Mr. Burns, he's okay.
Jackpot!
Mr. Brown Shoes.
Mr. Brown Shoes. You know, how about that local sports team? It works still with strangers, you know? If ever were I at a party again with strangers in person, I would definitely say, how about that local sports team, too?
I also love the mustachioed guy that we see sometimes, and I love that we refuse to give him a name. Like, we could have given him a name here. No, he's just mustache guy.
Yep. Yeah, he's,
only
he's
like Carl, Lenny, and Charlie, I think, are named out of all of his work friends.
And Charlie barely counts.
Yeah.
Charlie only exists of like, well, we need a fourth guy to like die in this scene or have a horrible thing happen.
Get sucked into a tube.
Yes. It's also, I always laugh seeing Burns' butt, just seeing his bony old behind.
Oh, yes.
This is still the era in which that was a fresh joke. I think that joke happens again in Stark Raving Dad. I could be mistaken, but it happens a few times. It was the era of ill-fitting hospital gown jokes.
Yes, yeah, yeah. And then, well, and also we saw Burns' butt a few times in his full nude appearance in Brush with Greatness. Also, great little effect on the green explosion as Homer like drops a very dangerous thing while he says, jackpot! So then Mr. Burns is killing it at High Lie. He has super incredible strength.
Oh, man, this wall run is so well animated. I just tweeted out a GIF of it I made with Frankie Yak. It's so great.
It's gorgeous. I do also love his, I guess, it's, I don't know if they're friends. I assume it's someone he's paying to play High Lie with him, or an instructor, possibly.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
Osvaldo.
Osvaldo.
Never seen again.
I knew High Lie as a kid because my dad was a fan of gambling on it. It was one of those things you can gamble on. Nobody would watch High Lie if you couldn't gamble on it. That's what I think. But it was a fun, you know, once you've bet on the ponies all day at the track, if you see like, here's a closed circuit TV of High Lie, it's like, well, all right. I mean, these are two guys. I only got to pick one or the other guy. who's gonna throw that thing first? And yeah, as Burns then celebrates how he's full of pith and vinegar, there's a great bit that was like, it was Silverman making something a joke. Because when he says, like, and all I really needed, zoom in, is the blood of a young boy. Like, Silverman wanted it to feel like a bit of a misdirect of, like, is this episode about Burns trying to steal the rest of Bart's blood? Like, what? Yes. Just the sinisterness to it is so funny.
Much like a billionaire that we won't mention ever again.
Yeah, yeah.
Just, well, parodies and jokes.
Yeah. I was looking up on that guy who may not exist, and he is very open about this. I think he hasn't started doing it yet, but he's like, no, I really want to get regular blood infusions from an 18-year-old man, and it's all about these billionaires are trying to like solve death, like, well, no, I'm gonna live forever, I'm very important, you see. We saw it didn't really work out that way for Steve Jobs, but hey buddy, we're rooting for you.
the rest of them are trying. Yeah, I mean, they all think they'll live as long as Mr. Burns, you know, but like, yes. Yeah, I mean, well, honestly, longer. I mean, also with Peter Thiel, another funny publicly known fact about him is that like he's this very distant, weird, very rich man, and he is giving a ton of money to J.D. Vance, who is trying to for the Congress in Ohio. I'm like, yeah, I'm just a regular guy, I'm sick of these elites. And it's like, your main funder is the guy who buys blood and is a billionaire. Like,
oh man, I mean, this is slightly off topic, but I love, no matter how much money they throw at that guy, that dog won't hunt.
No,
it's not gonna work.
No. It's never gonna happen for him, and it's fantastic. And I mean, it's just the best watching. He's one of those people that I love to watch fail. And I mean, like, there's so much bad in the world, but every so often it's like, he'll never be anything. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, it's the J.D. Vance, the only person who's going to beat him will be another Republican, so you can't root too hard for the guy who's going to beat him. But it's like, oh yeah, this J.D. Vance looks so fake and phony to even the average Republican voter. He's like, no, this guy's full of shit. Like, and I mean, it doesn't help him that he tried to rebrand as like, oh, I'm an anti-Trump guy, and then later after that didn't work, he's like, oh, did I say anti-Trump? No, I'm just as pro-Trump as anybody.
I love that dude.
Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah. Once his movie failed and people didn't accept him as the hillbilly whisperer, he's like, fuck. All right. Well, you know what? Actually, I agree with Trump and I'm going to trigger you liberals. Yeah. Anyways, Bart is named to Burns as the man who gave, as the boy who gave him the blood. And it's just, Burns forgets the Simpsons names three times in this episode. It's so great.
And it's another mislead. He's like, oh, they'll get something very nice from me. Very nice indeed.
I love that's such a great joke. It feels like a George Meyer joke that this person laughs knowingly, but within, as a sitcom mislead, it works great. But if you take it as reality, this person is insane. Why is he laughing like very nice indeed? A card that just says thank you. Like, why is that making him laugh so hard?
It's just maybe he's just so excited for them to not to think that they aren't going to get a card at all. But oh no, they'll get a card. They'll get a very impersonal card.
They would think I wouldn't send a card, but they're getting a card. The nicest thing anybody's ever gotten from Mr. Burns. So it cuts to home. Homer's throwing out bills, which they build on this joke for an even better joke in the George Meyer written Mr. Lisa Goes to Washington. And then when he sees Burns, the address is on Mammon Street, which is correct for the Thanksgiving episode. That is the street that Burns lived on in that episode. And and Homer is so excited. He's losing it. I just love, he picks up Bart. He's like, oh boy, oh boy. And then he even is just like telling Lisa, do something. And she just turns on the sprinkler. But as Homer.
Oh, by the way, they're at 94 Evergreen Terrace. We're not at 742 Evergreen Terrace.
Said it yet. Wow, I missed that. My eyes were drawn to the return address. I didn't even miss that. It's 742 will be the address. It'll be like used as not their address a couple times before it finally becomes their address. But that's more of a season four thing. Yeah. As Homer opens it up, his slow realization that it is nothing and he got nothing. My favorite bit is Lisa sadly just silently just turning off the sprinkler.
I'm not a jerk like Homer, but when I get a card for my birthday or Christmas, I'll open it up, not like and shake it, but as soon as I open it up and nothing falls out, I'm like, okay, maybe they're telling me where I can pick up my gift.
I as a kid would certainly in a very selfish way of like, oh, birthday card, open it sideways, not to read it, but to see what falls out. Like, all right, is this a check or cash? If it's cash, it's mine right now. If it's a check, I got to give it to mom to take to the bank.
I'm very Jerry Seinfeld. How soon can I throw this away? I hold on to nothing. It's very nice of you that you got me a card. Yes, the gift card is uber important, obviously. I do think now in the world of digital gift cards, you do sort of lose that. I mean, I know, whatever, who cares? But like, so now it's like you get a card and it's like, oh, I also emailed you a gift card. It's like, well, then why give me the card? Just write me a nice email. It's fine. Mm-hmm. Let's go full digital for doing it.
Yeah. You know what? The Postal Service has a lot on their plate right now.
Let's not involve the garbage man in this.
Bob, you gave me so much insight into why gift cards are good as a gift for people. Now they're not impersonal or just like, oh, you don't think it's to tell somebody like, I want you to have fun at this place. I give you permission to spend money at this, mm-hmm. on this meal, yes. or on this video game. Have at it.
Personalized gift cards rule. Amazon gift cards are like, I don't care about you or the environment.
That's true. If it's an Amazon gift card, it's like, buy whatever. I don't care, man. I'm sure you have coffee filters you need. Use it on that. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But yes, Homer is losing it at this idea of what little he was given.
Homer, you don't do things like that to be rewarded. You do them because a fellow human being needs a helping hand.
Marge, you're my wife, and I love you very much, but you're living in a world of make-believe with flowers and bells and leprechauns and magic frogs with funny little hats.
Yeah, Mom, we got hosed.
We got exactly what we wanted out of this. We gave an old man a second chance.
I promised my boy one simple thing. Lots of riches. And that man broke my promise. Well, I've had it. Bart, take a letter. Dear Mr. Burns, I'm so glad you enjoyed my son's blood. And your card was just great. In case you can't tell, I'm being sarcastic. You stink.
Could you read that last part back to me?
You stink!
Good. You are a senile, buck-toothed old mummy with bony girl arms, and you smell like...
an elephant's butt?
An elephant's butt!
Okay, there's a lot here. First thing on the sarcastic thing. I love how many levels that works on because the way Homer says it, it's so obvious he's being sarcastic that you would not need to say, in case you can't tell, I'm being sarcastic. But then the next step is about how if you were to write down your sarcastic thoughts in tone-free text, you actually do need to tell someone you're being sarcastic.
We didn't have sarcasm tags yet.
Yes, yeah. And I mean, on Mr. Show, they did an even better joke with this idea of just like, oh, I love your cereal. I want to have a box of it every single day.
And they keep sending it.
They also use that joke. I mean, it's really close to the Flaming Moe's, in case you can't, because he starts by telling Marge that she's in a fantasy world and not in a gumdrop house on Lollipop Lane, but close. And then, in case you couldn't tell, I'm being sarcastic. It's very, very similar.
Yeah, the acting is not quite as extreme as it would become in that one. This is like the practice version.
There was something for Silverman. Like, this was a breakthrough moment for Silverman. He talks about it on the commentary, but like, when he heard this delivery by Castellaneta of these lines for Homer, he's like, you know what, layout guy, give me this. I'm going to basically animate, or at least like pose out, this entire sequence. That's why Homer pops into like 8 different moves. Like, this grew then into that one. And then I'd say even bigger was Homer's speech of in front of the sugar pile is even bigger than this one. And it was just huge. Like, I believe Silverman calls it his Homer's fairy voice is what they put in quotes for it. But yes, it's so, I mean, I love too, like, if it wasn't so humorously animated, it would come off as extremely cruel to think like, you know, to tell to your spouse, I love you very much, but you live in a land of make-believe. Like, you're a fucking idiot. Like,
God, yeah, he's such an asshole. And I just love the staging. I'm looking at it on Frankiac, and I love how, speaking of Citizen Kane, you can see the ceiling of the kitchen, and the camera's like on the ground almost, looking up at the table from below.
Yeah. Man, it's not as flat as they'd get to do it in later ones. Like, this is kind of a peak for them animation-wise in a certain way.
And one of the saddest things is probably Bart's best memory as a child is when his dad rubbed his head after he said an elephant's butt. Yes. You know what I mean? Like, it's like so much affection. And it's a really nice, again, the blocking is fantastic because it's really well animated. But it's like, yeah, an elephant's butt.
And so this entire 5 minutes of the episode is actually a tribute / ripping off of a classic Honeymooners episode.
Is this set on the commentary? Or?
They do say.
Okay, I must have missed it.
So on the commentary, they say, some people have pointed out this is similar to the Honeymooners, but I watched the episode Letter to the Boss. It is exactly this one. And
yes,
not to sound like an old man, but you know what them Honeymooners, that doesn't get better in sitcom writing, but it really doesn't. Like, yeah.
And performance. I'm a huge Honeymooners guy. And I actually, it was funny because I haven't watched Honeymooners in a while for whatever reason. But I looked up just the script of that episode just to sort of like, is it that close? And it is. And I was just laughing because you could hear how Gleason would say it. Like, the you dirty bum, the amount of juice that gentleman got from the word bum is just... Oh.
I'm sure you can see the set, the walls in the set swaying back and forth.
Yes, yeah.
Oh, man.
Swaying in the breeze.
Like, I think Silverman on the commentary said, this Homer and Bart team up, they're very much like Fred and Barney. And that was said to Silverman in a complimentary way. So I can see, like, Jackie Gleason and Art Carney.
Yes.
Yeah. They're borrowing a lot from that dynamic.
No, this is just Ralph and Norton. So, yeah, in the episode, which also would have been fresh in their minds writing this in 1990, because the Letter to the Boss episode was was not in the short Honeymooners history thing. There were the classic episodes of Honeymooners, which was 39 episodes, and that's what played in syndication for 8 million for decades, pretty much. And then there were episodes that were technically episodes of the Jackie Gleason show, and people thought, oh, these are lost forever. They don't exist. And then in the 80s, a television historian discovered some kinescopes of a few of those lost episodes. And that then led late in life Jackie Gleason himself to discover, too, like, oh, I actually do have the originals of all of these lost episodes. And so they were put back into circulation, and it was this rediscovery of how great The Honeymooners was. So Letter to the Boss was actually like a new Honeymooners episode to sitcom writers back then. The quick version of the story is Ralph is told at work, like, give us your uniform. You're not going to need it anymore. He thinks he's been fired. He decides he's going to write an angry letter to his boss. Norton dictates it for him, just as Bart dictates it from Homer. He tells Norton to mail it off, and then Ralph meets one of his old work buddies who tells him, well, yeah, you just got a promotion. That's why they asked you to give up your thing. He tries to get Norton to not mail the letter. Norton has already mailed it. They even have a battle in front of the mailbox that is interrupted by the mailman who takes the mail from them.
And, oh, wow.
But the twist at the end of that one is even better than the twist in this episode of it, which is Ralph Cramden is there for his boss reading the letter. And he's like, oh, look at these things. A crank letter. You get these every once in a while in management, Cramden. Let me read it to you. And then Ralph is like, Jackie Gleason, his face is perfect. He's just losing it. And then the guy gets to the end of it and he says, like, sincerely, etc., etc. The guy didn't even write his name. And it's because Norton took dictation and Jackie Gleason said, sincerely, etc., etc. And so Norton just wrote, etc., etc.
Okay.
And then Ralph, like, drops dead. He just, like, goes, whoa! He, like, passes out. It's such a great, it's one of the funniest things.
Apparently you can watch it on Tubi, and I was just thinking there's a Seinfeld that's a lot like that. They update the technology and it's either Jerry or George, they need to get answering machine tape from a girlfriend's apartment. I think it's George.
That's right. Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah, that's right. Also, it has a joke that the Monsters, Inc. stole or did an homage to. Norton and Ralph are talking about how, like, well, then we're going to break into the mailbox and steal the mail, and they don't realize that a police officer is right behind them as they're describing it. And so when the police officer says, like, so what was that again? And then Ralph, after a lot of humana, Ralph says, yes, those were lines we were running for a play, and we'll invite you to the play, buddy. That's what Mike and Sully say when they get caught talking about the lost child. They say, oh, it's a play. But in Monsters, Inc., they go the extra mile of then having the play performed live at the end of the movie.
I forgot about that.
Yes. And that movie, co-directed by David Silverman. All right, we're back in The Simpsons. Oh. Okay. But yes, everybody, look that up on Tubi if you can. It's or somewhere else. It really, really, really is funny. I hate to sound old and say, like, no, this 70-year-old thing is hilarious, but it really is.
The kids don't watch enough Honeymooners, and I do think I imagine it holds up, because I can't imagine it's super, you know, quote-unquote problematic, because they don't talk about anything except for, like, the bus, you know what I mean? Yes. Like, there's almost no race stuff because everyone's white.
Yes.
You know what I mean, etc., etc. So it's like, sort of, yeah, I imagine it holds up fairly okay in that context.
I don't think you'd see it. Every show on TV now is about aspirational people who have, like, great lives and great, like, in the episode I watched, they do jokes about how he's like, if I lose this job, like, we're screwed. Like, we have no savings. We got to move back in with your parents. And then he says, we'll probably have to move to a terrible tiny apartment. And then he walks around the set that there is their apartment, and the whole audience explodes with laughter. Cause, like, they know your apartment is shit already. But yes, in this case, Bart is the Ed Norton and Marge is the Alice telling her, like, can you sleep on it? Though in The Honeymooners, Ralph says, like, basically just says, shut up and get out of here. I'm going to write it down right now. Get the hell out. Like, he's much meaner than Homer is to Marge.
Yeah, I guess that's what doesn't hold up so much is the constant threats of physical abuse from the husband. Yeah, that'll ruffle a feather or two, probably rightfully so.
But it's realistic for the 50s. You can't deny that. Yeah. But yes, Homer is convinced to sleep on it, and he dreams of first shaking all the money out of Burns, which I love the animation on that. And then the very corny music as Burns turns into a syrup bottle and he eats pancakes.
It's such a great, fun little dream sequence in a thought bubble, like out of a comic strip. And I love how well both Marge and Bart know Homer more than he knows himself. They both realize you will be very angry, you're super emotional, but then you'll immediately get over it and be distracted by something like food.
Yeah.
Both Bart and Marge know that.
That Homer is already famous for his extreme mood swings.
Also, I do love the animation on the dream sequence. It's a very early Simpsons thing with that one color dream kind of a thing. They're both green. It reminds me very much of, I think, Homer explaining what happened or his night out. It's purple. I've lost that, but yes.
Yeah. No, I mean, also it's like his dream sequence. Well, definitely his golden slumbers dream sequence in season three is he's falling asleep while driving.
Yes.
But this always makes me hungry for pancakes because that big pile of pancakes looks so good. Man, I love pancakes, which are a great breakfast and not just like dessert.
It's a point of contention on this podcast. Yes, I'm the waffle guy.
It's interesting. My wife had pancakes. We went to brunch the other day. She had pancakes. And I was like, you know, I have not willingly had pancakes in about 25 years. And I think it's because I'm more of a waffle person. Mm. But the pancakes looked, and I tried them. They were delicious. And I might, Henry, right now I'm a Bob, but by the end of this year, I might be a Henry. We'll find out.
You know, I do understand, though, that pancakes are like one of the easiest things to make at home. So going to a restaurant, like, that's where I'd be like, well, I can make pancakes at home, but I can't make like Eggs Benedict or whatever. I should order something fancier there. But yes, as Homer wakes up and is happy and decides not to mail it, we cut to Bart happily whistling as he walks down into the mailbox. And
that should have been the act break. They are so nervous about this show and where to put the act break that this has the longest first act in the entire show's history. This is a two-act episode.
Yes, yeah. It's crazy. This is 11 minutes, 11 seconds when it hits the commercial break, which, yes, longest. That is halfway of the episode.
I have 15 minutes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Man,
that Bart putting the thing in the mailbox, that is not the act break, and it should be.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Then it's when Homer gets thrown out of the thing.
That's the one act break in the episode. They'd never do it again, but they were talking about in the commentary, we wanted the stakes to be very high. We wanted to show you the effects of what the letter did before we did an act break. But I think Bart putting the letter in the mailbox could have been the act break.
Yes. Okay. See, I read it as that. You're right. Yeah. But yes, we then cut back to Homer freaking out, and this is when he asked Bart if he has seen that letter.
It didn't just get up and walk away. Bart, have you seen the letter?
Yep.
All right. Think very carefully. Where did you see it last?
The last place I saw it was in my hand.
Yeah?
As I was shoving it into the mailbox.
Oh! Why did you do that?
Dad, there were things in the letter that had to be said, and I know you. You're an emotional guy. Just because you were mad last night is no guarantee you'd be mad in the morning, so I think...
Are you mad in the morning?
Homer, you encouraged him. You should be strangling yourself.
She's right. Okay, Jake Homer, don't panic. They don't pick up the mail till noon. There's still time.
Bart's delivery of like the last place I saw it, like he's dragging it out to really get over
it. It really feels like that commentary by Marge should have been the last strangling joke we had, because she's pointing out how violent an act it is. And it's kind of disturbing because when Marge is yelling at Homer, he still has his hands wrapped around Bart's neck, and Bart is like pounding on his fists.
Hands. Stop, please, God.
It's like the only time she intervenes. Every other time I guess it's because of the logic of the situation. She's like, now Homer, in this one instance, I think you shouldn't strangle our son because you encouraged him. Otherwise, yes, you should strangle him. Go strangle away.
And I also love how then in the animation, he goes like, she's right. And he like is reaching at his own throat for just a second. He's like, oh, should I literally strangle myself? No, no, no. And he pulls his hands away. But also the big cutaway to outdoors on the dough. Like, that's always fun. A big Homer dough so loud that like Ned can hear it from outside. On the zoom in of Bart explaining it, it's like, that's again, just a great like directorial choice. It's like a Dutch angle and a zoom in on Bart as he explains it, you know? So yes. Then it's time to battle the mailbox again. Exactly how it goes in the Honeymooners episode. They don't try to water the mail. They just pick up the mailbox, and then the postman shows up, and he says, "What are you doing?" And then Jackie Gleason, Ralph, says, "Oh, some kids had flipped it over, and we're putting it back." So everything's fine.
I like how Homer promises he's got a little trick up his sleeve, and it's just violence. Yes. It's just physical violence.
And Barney, of course, is fighting the power, which I just love. That just having no idea of what the situation is, but yeah, let's kick some mailboxes.
It's like we're taking down the government one mailbox at a time, and Barney's here for it. And then it's Homer gets the great idea that he's just going to destroy every piece of mail that's in that. I love his like Bart is the one who's more responsible here, and Homer's speech about like dear so and so, like blah blah blah.
Signed, who cares?
Yeah. Yours truly, some bozo, big loss. and yes, and then the mail carrier who arrives, it's the one who delivered the spy camera to Bart in Homer's night out.
Well, no wonder she knows where they live.
That's right. She's sick of them already. Again, another great line from Homer, like, there's no point in running away since you deliver your mail carrier and you know who I am. That's right. Well, I'm still going to run. And Bart just like goes like, well, okay, and just walks away. Meanwhile, we cut to, this feels like a late edition of a very simple B plot, but I love it. The ghostwriter for Burns's book.
I want the whole world to hear the story of my harrowing struggle with hypohemia.
Well, sir, Mr. Roman is one of the finest ghostwriters in the business. He's written Like Hell I Can't, Up from the Muck, The Unsinkable Sidrudin Mabaradad.
Excellent. All right. First question. Have you slept with anyone famous?
Well, Countess von Zeppelin did I...
What in place? Now you listen to me, you bargain basement Baudelaire. I'm not some dizzy starlet who can't string two words together. I can write this thing myself. You're fired.
Oh, God. Everything about it, I mean, this isn't either the episode. It just gives Burns more plot. And I feel like if this was like even five episodes earlier in season two, James L. Brooks would have said, your B plot can't be about Burns. It has to be about one of the family members.
Yeah, a Burns story with a Burns B plot.
Yes. Yeah.
They were obsessed with him.
This whole thing, a great design on the very wormy ghostwriter. Like, he's so great. And that he instantly is like, well, do you have sex with anybody famous? The person he names is Baron von Zeppelin, died in 1917, just to show you how old the Countess would be. And yes, the Unsinkable Sedruden Mabaradad is kind of a reference to Titanic survivor, the Unsinkable Molly Brown, played by Kathy Bates. Thank you, Stevens. Kathy Bates in the Titanic film.
They really like the name Sedruden Mabaradad. It would come up two more times, and we'll count them every time, believe you me. Yeah. One's in Camp Krusty, one's in another place.
And also, Like Hell I Can't, that is a reference to Sammy Davis Jr.'s Yes I Can, which will also be quoted in Like Father Like Clown, where he says, the Jews are a swinging bunch of people. But it's so great that Burns just like throws it out and just goes like, the second he's asked like, have you slept with anybody famous, he's like, get out of here, I can write this myself.
And also apparently he subscribes to the New York Yorker, with this erudite crip about him being a bargain basement Baudelaire.
Yes.
It's very un-Burns for me, but very humorous.
We already recorded Mr. Lisa Goes to Washington, also written by George Meyer, and George Meyer loves making fun of bad writing. Mm-hmm. We don't hear a lot of it in this, but what we do hear is superb, and I love it.
I love every second of it, yes. It's so good. And speaking of great writing, this joke is like an all-timer Simpson scene as we arrive at the post office.
Hello, my name is Mr. Burns. I believe you have a letter for me.
Okay, Mr. Burns. What's your first name?
I don't know. Great plan, Bart.
Here's the thing. They're not comfortable with making Homer that stupid, so they have to add the tag, great plan, Bart.
That's true, yes. Though I guess, I mean, it makes him dumb enough to listen to Bart's plan, but I mean, that's...
One needless touch I love in this little establishing shot of the post office is you see this great mural, and if you go into the oldest post offices in your city, there will usually be one of those if they're old enough, because during the Depression, the WPA, they would pay artists to just make art. Isn't that a crazy idea? When the economy's bad, the government makes jobs?
Yeah.
no, man. Sorry, Jack. It's not gonna fly.
Well, fortunately, we'll never have that again. Like, it only led to like the biggest economic expansion in American history right after that. But whatever.
There's a really cool one in our Berkeley post office that is rapidly deteriorating, as everything is in this country.
I thought of our post office as I saw that painting. I was like, oh yeah, our ancient post office is a perfect example of like America falling apart. That the last time it had an investment made into it was now, I'd say, 90 years ago, and it's just falling apart. And I hate going to that post office. Every time I go to that post office, I leave it incredibly furious. But I can't. But part of my anger is, I don't even want to be mad at the people who work there, because I'm like, yeah, you guys have nothing. I know you have nothing. Like, you're giving me exactly what you should give me, which is the nothing you're given. You know, I understand, but it's infuriating, the post office. But yes, just the voice Homer puts on to pretend to be Mr. Burns, and also just his the confidence of I don't know.
Also, the speed in which Azaria gets his straight man line out, just like, okay, Mr. Burns. Like, and you could play it where you're trying to catch him, but he's literally just asking a man what his first name is. Mm-hmm. And his plan just easily falls apart. I love it.
And I know from experience, when we interviewed David Silverman, the director of this episode, the one time we had him on our podcast, he actually does say, I don't know, in reaction to questions about Simpsons history if he does not recall them, which is great. To know that Simpsons people quote Simpsons themselves even was such a fun thing to find out. But yes, we quick cut to Mr. Burns, where we hear his next chapter title. So funny. A trip to the infirmary with most unexpected results. Which, if you're reading this book, it is not unexpected. You know he doesn't die. You're reading his book.
I love the premise of the book is about his struggle with this disease that has only affected him once at the age of 100.
Yes. Oh, God.
Just once, and it worked out just fine, really quickly.
And just the satisfaction on Burns' face every time he writes an incredible cliche, because he thinks he's the first person to ever think of it. Like,
what I think of when I see these autobiographies now is, I'm sure it was happening back then and even earlier, but I feel like it's happening with even greater magnitude, that whenever anyone is running for president, their autobiography is immediately released. There's got to be a ghostwriter, and it always has a title like Courage like Building Strength or whatever, just these very broad generic titles.
Well, I mean, not that he was the first one to do it, but it really did work very well for Barack Obama. Like, his
that dude is on his eighth autobiography. Yes, frankly, I've heard enough.
So you're the first black president. We get it. We get
Now he's teaming up with Bruce Springsteen to write books.
That's true. Yeah. I'd like a mystery novel by those two guys. Ooh. But yeah.
Like Clinton's mystery novel, yes. The President is Missing.
He's got one mystery he doesn't want anyone to solve.
No. but yeah, Obama did it so well, and everybody loved his book, that everybody's like, well, if I'm going to run for president, I have to sell these books. And also, like, it's why as much as we love Bernie Sanders, people like get him on, like, you're technically worth $2 million. He's like, yeah, I sold a book, okay? Give me a
Yes. And those books always sell for whatever reason. Old people want to read books called Moving Mountains or whatever the hell it's called.
our friends on Podcast The Ride spotlit a guy who's like, his one was called like, There's Always a Paddle Coming for Your Ass. Like,
unfortunately, Joe Biden's is called Promises to Keep. Now, slightly ironic these days.
you know, it's not
promises
too late
to make.
I bet he could kids technically say when he said $10,000 of college debt forgiveness, that wasn't a promise. It was a suggestion.
He said doll hairs. You weren't listening.
And really, Bob, it was technically $2,000.
Yes,
you know?
He completed the $2,000.
As he always promised. Anyway, then Homer is going to try one last chance to get the letter, which is exactly what Ralph Cramden does. He sneaks into his boss's office and gets caught as well.
For Operation Mail Take.
though his boss doesn't pretend he's about to stab him. But yes, Burns reads his letter.
Who are you?
Don't tell him. Give him a fake name.
Homer Simpson.
Oh!
Simpson, huh? Simpson! Why, there's a letter here from you. I'll just read it right now. Dear Mr. Burns, I'm so glad you enjoyed my son's blood, and your card was just great. Why, Simpson, you've made my day. You're a true gentleman.
Yeah, well, I'll be on.
Hello, there's more. In case you can't tell, I'm being sarcastic. You stink. You are a senile, buck-toothed old mummy with bony girl arms, and you smell like an elephant's butt.
Hey, come on, Joey. You have to twist my arm?
Homer, I don't tell you how to do your job, okay?
I could crush him like an ant, but it would be too easy. No, revenge is a dish best served cold. I'll bide my time until... Oh, what the hell, I'll just crush him like an ant.
Yeah, so 16 minutes in, first act break. Go ahead, Steven.
Out of bony girl arms. Gonna make me laugh every time. Sorry, folks.
Buck-tooth old mummy. If I call somebody old an old mummy, I think of this. This is a short Henry's Tale to tape, but I never get to hear the end of that one in my childhood videotape of this because we messed up on the pause. We wanted to cut out this commercials, and so didn't hear Burns's amazing last line of this scene for so many years until I got the DVDs. But I love that at this point even Burns is sick of his big flowery speech. He's like, forget it, I'll clear some like an ant. Though Silverman on the commentary misremembers, he says that this is the first time Homer's brain has talked to him, which is not true. It was three episodes earlier in Lisa's Substitute. That was the first time Homer's brain spoke to him. But Silverman does credit Brad Bird, animation and live action director superstar Brad Bird. It was his idea to have the camera pan up to Homer's brain and pan down. That was his idea.
That's a great choice.
But I do love is like Burns reads that and compliments him, and what a silly thing, like, hello, there's more, like, you know, there's more text on it. That's such a great line. And this is when we also meet Joey, the very businessman-like goon, who he'll get a different name later.
He's either Crusher or Low Blow.
Right.
But here he's just, I love that he has a goon on retainer, like a guy that is absolutely willing to beat somebody up 100%, no problem.
And it's
a guy that he likes too.
Yeah, that maybe it's because I've been doing a full rewatch of the entire series of Sopranos, but it reminded me so much, like in Sopranos, that's taken as reality, a guy who's just like, yeah, I play poker with him a few times. Good guy. Will you beat the shit out of him? Oh, yeah. Consider it done. Got it right there. Like, yeah, just the sociopathy of these big friendly guys who, once you tell them, like, well, it's part of your job to beat him up, like, consider it done. Horribly beaten. Gonna do it. Like, same with him saying, like, do you have to twist my arm? And yeah, Silverman regrets that they changed the line that originally was like, yes, I do. It's called being compliance. Like, that's the line. But I kind of like better the line of, Homer, do I tell you how to do your job? Like,
I mostly think of this Joey guy as the guy in Marjorie of the Monorail who is told, I like the way Shrub thinks. He's the skeptical guy who doesn't believe Mr. Shrub isn't Mr. Burns.
That's right. He's ready to beat the shit out of Smithers and Burns in that moment. They have to run out. They have to grappling hook out of there, like out of 1989's Batman. But yeah, so Homer has been fired. He's thrown out. Burns then even signs his pink slip. An amazing penmanship.
On Smithers' back. It's a nice little touch of acting there.
I love it. It's like, liver spots, did I? Like, that's a good one. Yes.
I think one of them is blank, would we?
Yes.
I love that he's just, it's not enough. He wants blood, actually, which is kind of funny.
No, that's such a great like misdirect too. Yeah. And he says,
yes,
it feels so strange. I just destroyed a man's life with this pen, and yet I feel so empty. You know what? Haven't beaten to a bloody pulp. Like, it's in a lesser sitcom, it would have been him saying like, you know what? I shouldn't fire him. Why? There's something wrong with me. And so he's like, oh no, this isn't satisfying because he still has his bodily function. Like, he's not horribly beaten and put in the hospital. meanwhile, Homer is reflecting on how much his life is ruined in this fun little clip.
Honey, what's done is done. No matter what happens, we'll pull through. We always do.
Okay, here's a plan. You can move in with your sisters and raise the kids, and I'll die in a gutter. It's practical and within our means.
They always told me I was going to destroy the family, but I never believed it.
That's okay, Bart. Nobody really believed it. We were just trying to scare you.
I love that line so much. Like, that, and that I think comes from the same, I think it's a George Meyer line, because it feels so much like the mean family interactions that are in part of Thanksgiving. Just the Bart saying like, oh yeah, everybody has always told me you ruined this, you're gonna destroy this. Mm-hmm. And that Lisa has to give up the game of like, no, he didn't really mean that. We were just trying to scare you. It was just being cruel to you saying that stuff. But also just Homer's like, it's practical and within our means. Like, great, great delivery. Well, and speaking of great deliveries,
yes,
here, yeah.
There are so many line readings that were burned into my developing brain, and this is definitely one of them, and I get excited whenever I hear it.
Yes. It says, could you imagine, in this next clip, could you imagine now hearing Harry Shearer try this hard?
No.
In anything.
You know Homer Simpson?
Yeah, nice guy. Play poker with him once in a while.
Mm-hmm. We need him beaten up.
You got it.
Wait.
What is it?
Nothing. Wait.
What?
Beat, but don't kick.
Hold the kicks. Got it.
Wait.
What?
Hey,
what did homie do anyway?
He saved Mr. Burns' life!
That's so good. Mr. Burns' life!
Yeah, you get some phlegm in there, which you will not get Harry Shearer ever showing.
No.
Well, he's got a lot of phlegm now, but that's just because he's like in his 80s, you know. Just, it happens.
Yeah,
to
that's
all.
Also true.
Yeah. But, no, just as like, when you're
getting into Cookie Monster territory there.
Well, when it, you know, when it bubbles up and you're that
Mr.
upset.
Mr. Burns.
Yeah. Also, another like great little moment is when Joey turns around to say what, like the way he like kind of bounces and puts his hands up, like in a shrug, he's like, what? Like, come on. That's another great drawing too. And also, you know what, this kind of precedes his characterization in Who Shot Mr. Burns, when Smithers is, you know, Mr. Bowtie and very effete and shaven and all that, but when he's in stress, he's a smoker, he stops
drinking.
Yeah. I definitely think in the design for Smithers and Who Shot Mr. Burns, they looked back to this of like, okay, what's a strung out Smithers look like?
He's not coughing up an entire ashtray's worth of debris, though.
Unfortunately, no. Also, it's a great little thing. Like, he's looking at a photo of Burns and Homer at the same time as a way to express how embattled he is. Like, that's a really good, just like, you know, animation choice. Like, Silverman and his team are doing a great job in this. It shows, I've said it a million times, but I think an underrated thing about why people don't, I think that the show went down in quality that is not spoken to, is thanks to the success of King of the Hill and a bunch of other animated shows, they lost like 80% of their animation team in the late 90s, and there was really no rebuilding from that. They had such great artists on it before that they could never really catch up. And so Smithers decides it's time to confront Mr. Burns as Mr. Burns finishes his important work in our next clip.
In closing, gentle reader, I'd like to thank you. What's that you say? Me thanking you? No, it's not a misprint. For you see, I enjoyed writing this book as much as you enjoyed reading it. The end. Ah, Smithers, how'd the beating go?
Sir, there was no beating.
What? Well, that's a hell of a thing. Why?
Because I called it off.
Judas!
I'm sorry, sir, but I just couldn't hurt Homer Simpson. He saved your life.
I see.
I know you're mad at me, but I think it's only fair to warn you. I'm going to stand outside the gate until you forgive me.
No need, Smithers. As usual, you've been the sober yin to my raging yang. Put her there, old pal.
Sir, well, I wish this handshake would never end. I'm afraid we still have the Simpson matter to attend to.
We do indeed, old friend. We do indeed.
I consider Henry my sober yin.
And I'm the raging yang.
I'm the raging yang.
Oh, okay, got it.
You can't both be the raging yang, guys.
Bob called the yang.
I call yang.
That is a great scene, too, because it's like a parody of a sitcom, because that's the end of a sitcom there when they shake hands and make up, and then it lasts a little too long, and Smithers has to go like, well, technically, this isn't the end of the episode. We have to do another thing. And then Burns going like, we do indeed, old friend. We do indeed.
I love the phrasing, well, that's a hell of a thing.
Yes.
Like the idea that the beating, A, asking how the beating went. It went great. He got the shit kicked out of him. It was fantastic.
And then he's like, well, that's a hell of a thing. Why wouldn't that happen? What the and of course, yes, the great, it's one of like the worst cliches in writing. Like, oh, what's that? Me thanking you? No, it's not a misprint. Oh, so good.
I think I read like an Orson Scott card that had an intro like that.
Oh, God.
Oh, he's awful.
Yes. That it was not a joke in his case.
No.
Yeah,
it was like, you're such a genius for buying Ender's Game, but you know what? I'm a genius for writing it.
We're all great together. We have a quick cut to Moe's bar as Mo gets a prank call for Mike Roach. My crotch.
Missing tooth on Mo. I'm on missing tooth watch, and it's not there. I mean, it is there.
Oh, good, good.
The missing tooth is there, so the tooth is not there.
I love the cut to Bart and Lisa laughing on the phone. Such a great drawing. I love that. And also nice detail that, like, Homer is the only one not laughing because he's that unhappy. And this is before they got the mugs at Moe's. They're drinking out of the tall, drinking glasses instead of the mugs they normally drink
out. Yes, that was weird. I saw that, too. It's like, okay, it seems like a nicer bar all of a sudden.
Yes, yeah. I also loved just hearing Mo very concernedly saying, like, you should not drink to forget your problems.
And that's not a very Mo thing to say.
Yes, yeah. We're coming, we've already recorded, but in the parent rap, Mo pulls a gun on Homer and robs him of his $600 pants. Like, that's how different Mo is 10 years later.
I mean, we've seen the Mo like beer steins before, but I think he's trying to class up the place. But you know what? When you get a beer mug like that, a big glass like that, the rim is always chipped. You're going to feel a little bit of chip on that rim.
And you know, you can't send them all back. That's rule number one. Just turn the glass around. Both rims won't be, you know, both edges of the rim won't chip. Just drink around it.
It's a fun game to try to not cut your lips, you know? It's part of the excitement. Keeps you on your toes. I like hearing Barney say, you should only drink to enhance your social skills. That's a great line from old Barney.
And I love Burns seusing it up on the elevator. Both the voice acting and the animation, just very, very good. Just a static shot of him just moving upwards, delivering all of this very fun dialogue.
And the extra challenge too, that they make it a mirrored background so you see it from two angles. Like, that's so great. And it's, I also laugh that Maude and the Flanders boys are watching this like crazy guy freak out and talk about a zip zoop zabulous present.
And then we get the fun montage of all the presents they might get them. And I love this. I love Smithers with a banjo. I'm slapping my knee. I'm having a blast.
He's really hamming it up. I mean, this is like a repeat of the joke, the series of jokes from Life on the Fast Lane when Homer is looking for a gift for Marge, like, oh, too corny. Ooh, too exciting.
Right.
So it's them visiting a bunch of mall stores. I mean, the joke is like, malls have a store for everything. Well, not 30 years later, they don't.
No.
But it's like going to all these different like specialty stores, like the brushes are coming.
I often say too cutesy poo. Yeah. I describe things. I don't like things when they're too cutesy poo, including on this series. But I love his statement of it. And yeah, Smithers is the look on his face. He's so pleased at playing this banjo. That's so great.
And the pool table, clearly Burns has a 100-year-old stance on pool. It's like what you do in a public house.
Yes, yes.
And it's also obviously exactly the gift that Homer would like, at mm-hmm. least. You know what I mean? Like, would you like want to turn his house, his home, into a bar? Like, absolutely, if you could.
And what a great line of, like, a saloon. Like, such a fancy way of saying it.
But this store that they get the Olmec head from, I mean, you'll find these places in New York occasionally, like, they'll, like, have, like, just insane items that cost $1,000 each that are, like, a diamond-studded statue of a poodle, and you're like, who in the world would buy such a thing? I assume that's what the store is supposed to be, or have you run across stores that are similar to this?
I don't think I have, but I feel like those stores are for rich men who cheat on their wives. They need a really big gesture to get her back.
You know, I have the place that he ultimately buys something from, Plunderer Pete's. It does feel a little like, man, I can't remember the name of the place. It's it was like a rainforest type thing. And I remember it had like rain sticks in it, which is just like, you know, a stick with like ball bearings in it. And you turn it upside down. Sounds like rain. It's a great thing for a little kid to play with in a store. I am so glad my mom never, like, she was able to not waste money on that, because, like, what do you do with that? You spend like $40 on that for a kid, and they turn it upside down like four times, and then it just becomes like a thing they hit their brother with. That's all it
is. Or a thing your mom trips over.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm. but yeah, this is certainly a joke about, like, walking around a mall and thinking, who the hell buys this thing? Like, how does this place stay open? And actually, though it will air later, the episode before this in the season two production run, when Flanders fails, is about the same thing. Mm-hmm. It takes the idea of, like, there's a store for everything, even a left-handed item store, and mm-hmm. makes it the whole plot.
Although I will take that back. I think malls are turning back into this now, because malls are just selling space to local business people. And the last time I walked through at my local mall back in my hometown, I think earlier in 2021, it was like, I've never even heard of this store. It's not a chain. It's just some person selling things. They basically set up an Etsy
it's a
store.
Guy in a room with stuff.
Yes, there's like a folding chair. It's basically just like I set up my own Etsy store at the mall, because real estate is very cheap here.
You know, in one of our community's Simpsons news segments on the podcast, I remember seeing, like, it was a pop-up of an imitation Moe's that sells, you know, Simpsons food as a bar food. That was one of those things that's like, oh, yeah, it's in this dead mall, and you can go to it. Like, we built a Moe's in it for, like, 4 months, and you can enjoy it. And then closing up the Moe's, we're not staying open all the time in this Moe's. But it's, I guess really it is that everything is a Halloween store now. You know, like, everything is a fly-by-night one.
In and out. Yes.
it's all any business can afford these days. Also, I love that Burns's nose is squished up against the window as he looks at it. Like, that's such a great shot. And yes, it's a great, you know, it doesn't work as a mystery anytime after the first time, but when Burns is pointing at something in there and says it's $32,000, as a viewer, you're like, what the hell could this be?
Yeah.
What could it be? But we find out as the head is unveiled, they head home to, and Homer is crying on the couch saying, woe is me. And then Homer sees that Burns has arrived. And I noted this time that the movers who are bringing in the giant box, they're the movers from Treehouse of Horror's first segment who are moving them into the bad dream house.
And they don't talk because one of them is James Earl Jones.
Yep. Yeah. So this time, silent movers. But yes, Homer gets a gift in our next clip.
You brought us a present.
Wait, what did you think I was going to do? Have you beaten to a bloody pulp? To show there's no hard feelings, please take an advance copy of my book. Will there ever be a rainbow? And now, young fellow, I haven't forgotten you. Here.
Wow, a crowbar.
It's to open the crate, stupid.
What did I show you? I'll bet it's filled with diamonds, rubies, sapphire, pearls.
Wow! A big ugly head!
Oh. Actually, son, it's a big ugly Olmec Indian head. It was carved by Mesoamerican Indians over 3,000 years ago. This gruesome customer is Extapolapa Kettle, the god of war.
Awesome!
No, Maggie, not Aztec. Olmec. Olmec.
Marge, what does it do?
Doesn't do anything.
Marge, really, what does it do?
Whatever it does, it's doing it now.
Well, I'll let you get acquainted with Senor Extapolopakettle.
Ta!
Did you see their faces, Smithers?
Sir, you're my god of generosity.
By the way, Extapolopakettle, not real.
Made up!
Yeah. But him saying, Extapolopakettle, that's in my head as well.
Yes, yes. Now, of course, the Olmec people were a real group. The Mesopotamian culture, like one of the first cultures in the southern South America, I believe. But the point is that they did make big heads. Silverman even admits on the commentary, he's like, yeah, I have friends who collect pre-Columbian art, and they said, that head looks nothing like how the head. They actually embellished it and made it look more interesting. It's a rather kind of flat head design for the not many extra details, unless, you know, maybe they were painted a long time ago. But they, if you look up a real Olmec head, it's not as there's not as many like rings in it or all that.
I do love the detail. It's a great payoff of the flashcards gag of Maggie coming up with Aztec, and it's wrong, but it's incredible that she would identify any native peoples associated with it. It's a great little joke.
Yeah, I'm kind of sad that, I mean, this is 31 years later, and I know the mystery, but I remember it being a mystery when I first saw it. And I like how this is also secretly like one of the biggest pieces of Simpsons continuity, and that it's a mystery how they got this in the house and then into the basement, but it will be in the basement almost every time you see their basement. You will see the head like behind debris, yeah, or stacks of newspapers or whatever.
It's so great that they keep the head in there as many times as they can. Like even in the movie, when the house gets destroyed, you can spot the head in the, yes, big house destruction sequence. Oh, and I take that back. Sorry. The Olmec were in the tropical lowlands of the Gulf of Mexico in present day Mexican states of Veracruz and Tabasco.
Did you watch The Road to El Dorado or didn't you?
I know, I'm failing. You know, we went to all that. Well, you know, you were the main producer on that one.
It's true.
So, but yeah, the also, will there ever be a rainbow popped up a couple extra times in the series too. It was in The Last Temptation of Homer when they had their convention display for the plant. The book is on there. And in The Old Man and the Lisa, when Lisa says Burns' net worth, she is reading this book to source it. Mm-hmm. It says, like, in your most recent autobiography, you said you're worth this much. What a great like final joke about his book, about like, yeah, this, the most hacky dumb book of all time is called The Will There Ever Be a Rainbow. Like, what a great awful name. And also the way that Burns says it.
My life is full of gray clouds, even though you know, you're a total billionaire the entire time.
Yes, you've been rich your entire life. You've lived to be 100. You've done everything possible, but
you've had one setback and you should be dead. You've lived too long.
A thing that should have killed you of natural causes because you're old. He's like, oh, finally, I didn't die. But yes, I mean, the box is gigantic. The reveal of how it even get in there, you're like, what? No, this is impossible like that. It's so great and cartoony. And just the reveal, for a first-time viewer, what a great reveal of that thing, because you just go like, what? Like, what is this? And just the explanation that it is an incredibly expensive and rare thing. So it actually is a great gift in rareness and worth, but it is actually worthless, unuseful in any way, and actually a massive inconvenience, mm-hmm, for the Simpsons going forward. Like, such a perfect, perfect bad gift to give.
Couldn't you hawk it, though, for even like 15 grand? If someone's willing to pay 32, someone should be able to pay 15. And that's a huge, huge windfall for The Simpsons.
That's true. Mm. Yeah. But I guess, you know, maybe they feel like, ah, if we throw it out, Burns will know and we'll get in trouble or something. Or they just, or maybe Homer, you know, in his very selfish way is just like, no, it was the gift and I'm keeping it. Like, I'm gonna keep this forever.
The dynamic I read between Burns and Smithers this time is that Burns is definitely being passive aggressive. It's like, I'll give you a gift. And Smithers, because he can see no wrong in Burns, thinks, oh, what a nice thing my boss did, giving this family this priceless artifact.
Yeah. I also love too how Burns says, what do you think I was gonna do? Have you beaten to a bloody pulp? And then Smithers just laughs, and like, what a horrible in-joke joke to have with each other. Like, yeah, you almost did beat him to death. That's so funny. But yes, then comes the moral of the story, and one of the best closings of a Simpsons episode ever, I dare say. It's just a great encapsulation of this episode.
Save a guy's life, and what do you get? Nothing. Worse than nothing. Just a big, scary rock.
Hey, man, don't badmouth ahead.
Homer, it's a thought that counts. The moral of this story is a good deed is its own reward.
Hey, we got a reward. The head is cool.
Well, then, I guess the moral is no good deed goes unrewarded.
Wait a minute. If I hadn't written that nasty letter, we wouldn't have gotten anything.
Well, then I guess the moral is the squeaky wheel gets the grease.
Perhaps there is no moral to this story.
Exactly. It's just a bunch of stuff that happened.
But it certainly was a memorable few days.
Amen to that.
That's perfect. It does feel like a writer's room, too. Like, so what's the point of this?
Yeah.
How do we end this? And James L. Brooks is not flown in to have a character give a big grand speech. Mm-hmm. And again, like I said at the beginning, this does feel like the mission statement from here on out. Like, this sometimes will not have a pat ending that has a feel-good moment with nice music behind it. Sometimes it's like,
yes.
Wasn't that a bunch of fun jokes about one theme? All right, we'll see you. Watch Drexel's class. Come up next.
Yeah, yep. Or 90210 sort of, this week.
Oh, yeah, 90210. Yeah. Oh, Steve, sorry.
It's also super, it gets even more meta because they laugh at literally nothing. You know what I mean? Like, it ends on a big, like, oh, we're all just a big family laughing together. But, like, you're just saying it was a memorable couple of days and you're cackling. Like, it's a very a fun gag on sitcom endings.
And a great point that it's like, oh, this was just like 72 hours in your life. This is what it was. was this ridiculous thing? And also, they all laugh just because, like, well, it's the end of the TV show. You got to laugh at the end of it. Like, it's like they know they're at the end of a TV show. And yeah, also it feels like writers like tearing apart their story and just saying, like, well, this is the moral. It's like, well, no, this wouldn't have happened if Homer wasn't a jerk. Well, okay. And then, but yes, as a kid, I did not get how great it was to hear Lisa say, maybe there is no moral to this story. Just like, yeah, I've quit. Why are you looking for this in a TV show? Didn't you have a good time? That's all you gotta ask for.
It certainly was eventful.
Well, it's also very familiar to the end of Rosebud with it's an ending that's good enough, you know what I mean? Which
yes.
is, you know, is a happy ending or a sad ending, it's an ending.
And well, it's also, that's one where they help Burns and they actually do get nothing for it and they just go like yes. So actually, yeah, Rosebud, one of the greatest episodes of Simpsons ever, actually just rips off this episode.
Mm-hmm. I forgot about that.
I've got it coming in the mail. I haven't got it yet, but I recently made the splurgy purchase of a cell from Rosebud of Mr. Burns, future Burns, in his robot body holding the Bobo, and it's best hundreds of dollars I ever spent. but anyway, I love this as the last episode of season two. It shows, compare this to Bart Gets an F, which I think is a great episode, but they have grown so much. They've gotten so much confidence. Gene and Reese are taking over, and you know, they have their own ups and downs as showrunners, but this shows what they're really great at, which is like, this show is a zany satire of sitcoms, and we can do crazy shit you can't do in another sitcom. Why are we trying to be like other sitcoms with like a heartfelt ending,
mm-hmm.
or Homer telling Marge, like, I love you more than ever?
Oh, Homer.
Well, yeah, what do we need this shit for? Like, we can just be the funniest show on TV, and this is their way of showing it.
What's interesting, just kind of in the context of Honeymooners, that's what they were aping, obviously, right? It's the baby, you're the greatest ending. Like, you can't have an episode unless they don't kiss and he doesn't actually finally not only apologize, but let her know that she is the best. I mean, and also look at that guy and look at her. You know, you better be saying maybe you're the greatest a lot. Mm-hmm. But I mean, like, that's sort of that convention that it took them a while to get out of, I guess.
Yeah, I totally agree. And again, to restate what I said up front hours and hours ago, but this is really where it starts for me. It's not like the things before this you can discount entirely, but I feel like they figured everything out, the dynamic, the kind of jokes they can write, important characters like Smithers and Burns, and the idea of, you know, a fun ending that is very frivolous. frivolous and not wrapping everything up with a grand speech and nice music. So yeah, I'm very excited about doing this episode and excited about what's to come in season 3. So Steve, thanks for being on the show once again. You are from We Hate Movies. You've got a Patreon with a lot of great stuff happening behind the paywall, and also this will launch in the middle of February. What is going on with We Hate Movies?
We're just kind of doing a back to basics month. We did our We Love Movies month in December. We did a big worst of the 2021 era. Right now we're doing 90s movies. We've got we did Big Bully. We've got The Truth About Cats and Dogs is probably out at this point. And on our Patreon, you're getting for the We Love Movies feed, you're getting 2 full length episodes on Kill Bill Volume 1 and Kill Bill Volume 2. So that's all for the low price of $5. Not to be a huckster, pretty good deal. Best deal in podcasting. One of the best deals in podcasting.
Yes, I'm a proud patron.
I as well. Yeah, no, I'm looking forward to those. Truth About Cats and Dogs, saw that in the theater with my mom, and the only thing I remember is the extreme discomfort I felt during the phone sex scene in that movie.
That's not a mom movie for sure. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm glad you guys are moving on to lighter fare in February, because it felt like January was killing all of you.
Just all these 2.5 hour slogs. Now it's 90 minutes tops. That's what I'm looking forward to, folks.
Bass Jam, A New Legacy. I hope that we, it'll probably be on some poll at some point for us, but I hope to never have to go what you guys went through with that one. But thank you, Steve,
so much again.
It's always awesome having you back.
This was super fun. Revisiting season 2 was a blast with you folks, and I'm kind of gonna add this to my repertoire of running the Simpsons. It's not the same 150 episodes of the Simpsons to the ground. It'll now be the same 170 episodes of the Simpsons to the ground.
Broaden your horizon of Simpsons reruns you rewatch,
and that's it.
Yeah, only that way.
That is it.
So thanks again to Steve Sajdak for being on the show. Please check out We Hate Movies. We love it. As for us, if you want to check out more of what we do, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Sign up there for $5 a month. You get all these episodes 1 week ahead of time and ad-free, and also access to everything behind the $5 paywall. That includes our extensive back catalog of miniseries episodes, over 100 to date, and that also gives you access to monthly episodes of Talking Futurama and Talk King of the Hill, our regular podcasts about Futurama and King of the Hill, and that's all happening at the $5 level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and there is a $10 level as well. When you sign up for that, you get all the $5 stuff, of course, but also access to 1 megalong podcast once a month, only for patrons of that level or higher. And what is that, Henry?
Bob is talking about the What a Cartoon Movie podcast. You know, once a month we cover an animated series super in depth, just like we do The Simpsons on the What a Cartoon podcast. And also once a month we cover animated feature films just as in depth, which often means talking for up to or even over 5 hours about an animated feature film. We cover the history and scene by scene, just like we do with Simpsons, for films like last month we did The Lion King 2, Simba's Pride, the one of the best Disney sequels, I dare say, of the direct-to-video sequels, let's be honest here. And then this month, chosen by our patrons, we are doing the 1999 film South Park, Bigger, Longer, and Uncut, a film we all remember if you were a fan back then. So check out the entire back catalog of 3 years worth, over 200 hours of What a Cartoon Movie podcast, in addition to all the $5 things Bob mentioned at the $10 level. You'll see a big list of them if you visit patreon.com/talkingsimpsons to see it all.
As for me, I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. If you like the sound of my voice, I'm doing a lot of talking over on the Retronauts podcast. That is a podcast about classic games or retro games, whatever you want to call them. Please head on over to patreon.com/retronauts. Sign up there for 2 full-length bonus episodes every month. And Henry, what about you?
I'm H-E-N-E-R-E-Y-G on Twitter. Follow me there for all the cool updates in my life. And you should also be following the official Twitter account of this podcast network at Talk Simpsons Pod. You stay up to date with the news there. And also, if you're looking for an easy list of our all the free episodes we've done or other cool information about us, check out our official website, TalkingSimpsonsPodcast.com.
Thank you so much for listening, folks. We'll see you again next time for the next episode of our community podcast, Talk to the Audience, and we'll see you then.
Oop.
If you're in business, you probably have a website, but can your site handle your growth? How many visitors before your site slows down or crashes? What about storage and data security? From web hosting to virtual servers, Pear Networks provides the online infrastructure you need to start, grow, and flourish. When it comes to security and updates, don't worry, we've got you covered. Our 24/7 US-based customer support is the best in the industry. No frustrating chatbots or sitting on hold for hours. Check out pear.com today to learn more. That's PAIR.com.